I'm Lauren Tobin Miller, fourth child, third son, and welcome to Ruth Miller Unplugged.
Oh my God, the eagle has landed.
It's Toby.
Ruth Rochelle Bornstein Miller, mother, matriarch.
Did she give you much trouble?
Oh yeah, she's a troublemaker.
How's your flight?
I had to change planes, and I asked distinctly for a non-stop. But I had a change in Dallas, Fort Worth. So I'm gonna call them about that.
How are you walking?
I can't walk too far. Very hard for me. And I went in, so he told my doctor, he says, you take good care of her. She's my favorite patient. I said, he says, what did you do this time? I says, they're closing my baby factory. He says, how many do you have? I says, four. He says, that's enough. Let her close it. That's when my bladder fell out. Look what I found.
Do you have any tuna fish in there?
What?
Do you have any tuna fish?
You want some tuna? You want some tuna?
Do you have enough tuna fish?
You know, I forgot the tuna fish. Oh, look at this. I brought you a paper clip. Look at it. Press this orange button on the back. Well, look at it.
It's a football. That's great. I'll keep this forever.
Oh, here it is.
Female condom. Cool.
The thing is, I'm naturally very frugal. I was brought up that way because I never lacked for anything. I never wanted. I was very comfortable. My parents saw that I had everything I needed. But we weren't wealthy. You know, we were just comfortable because there were just the three of us and my dad worked very hard, used to canvas, go to all the towns and canvas. And my mom said when I was small, anybody would ask me, where's your daddy? My daddy's gone to buy suits. He used to buy suits from the farmers, go all around to the different towns, neighboring towns, Sarnia and all that. And he'd buy suits and he'd have them cleaned and fixed up and made just like new. He had a tailor working for him for many years. And then they started getting new clothes, and my dad never liked anybody to say he was in the used clothing business. They didn't like that. I thought they should have been proud of it, that, you know, they made a success, finally got a store on Olette Avenue. But he got all new clothes, and I worked for him for a while, and I had to type letters for him. And a supplier sent him suits. And, you know, Zadie had real wonderful sense of humor. So one shipment of suits that came in, he had me write, I'm going to have to ship these suits back to you, and don't bother charging me for them, because the only way you can sell these suits is in the dark at night when there's no lights on, because I shouldn't see what condition they were in.
You went off to Florida for high school for your senior year?
Yeah.
Why?
Well, what's this, Toby? Oh, I know what this is. Here.
Why did you go to Florida?
My dad is very difficult. And, gave my mother a very hard time when she was pregnant with Toby.
Bobby's my mother?
Huh?
Bobby's my mother?
I mean when she was pregnant with Bobby. This Freudian slip. When she was pregnant with Bobby, she couldn't void. She had to go be taken into the city every night to be catheterized by the doctor. And you know, that's very painful. I know because I wore a catheter for 2 weeks in the hospital the last time I was in.
Yeah.
And I got an infection from it too. How do you do this thing back out? And he had to take her. And he didn't like to be disturbed from his, whatever he was doing. He didn't like to have to go in with her every other night or every night, whatever it was. And he would yell at her and he'd swear and all this. It was very hard for her. Beside the pain, she had to have the verbal abuse. And I had to hear all that. And, you know, we had the cottage on Riverside Drive. And there was about a mile or two down the road, a bus took you from the city of Windsor to that section there, a little section. It wouldn't take any further down Riverside Drive. You had to get off there and people had to come and pick you up there at the bus stop. So I was very ambitious when I was young. And during the summer, I went to business school so I could learn how to type and take shorthand so I could work after, you know, during the summer when I got out of school. I wanted to know how to type and take shorthand. So I went to business school every day. And the bus would leave me off there, and my dad wouldn't come and get me. He just refused. So I had to walk 2 miles back to the cottage every night. And then I had to get up early in the morning and walk to the bus stop. Unless he felt better and he would take me on the way to opening the store.
What do you mean, felt better?
He was nasty. Zadie was always fighting.
Why?
Oh, I don't know why.
Was he drunk?
No. He was just... It's funny. He had a wonderful sense of humor, but he was kind of mean at times. Of course, in those days, we didn't have school buses either, and I had to walk with Doris and Florence. We walked a mile to school every day. We had to walk to school. And we had to take our lunches. We didn't have cafeterias. And even in the winter, we had to walk to school because my mother didn't drive in those days because she had that accident, that horrible accident. My dad wanted her to drive, and he gave her a teacher when we lived in East Windsor. And the teacher, they didn't have dual controls in those days. The teacher put my mother behind the wheel the first day that he was teaching her. She went right into a tree, and I was in the back seat of the car. And how old was I? Maybe 4 or 5. And all I remember is looking over in the front, and I saw just a pool of blood. That's all I saw, a pool of blood. And I must have banged my head. I was lucky. I just got a bump on my head. The doctor would come to the flat. We lived in a flat then, East Windsor. Doctor would come to stretch Bubby's leg, you know. They didn't have rehab like I had. I know it was horrible because it was very painful for me to learn to walk again. And he told my mother, he said, you'll never walk again. And he would come and he would bend her leg and she'd start screaming. And I'd run and run till I couldn't run anymore so I wouldn't hear her screaming. I couldn't stand it.
Where'd you run to?
I just went downstairs and started running until I couldn't hear her. I couldn't stand to hear her screaming. And then when Bobby was born, he was the last of mom had a lot of miscarriages. The doctor wanted to fix her up like new, because her insides were all torn apart from all the babies. So, because she had several miscarriages. And I had a brother who died before me. So she had to go to the hospital to have surgery.
There was the inebriated Moyle who...
That's the one that killed my brother, apparently. He wasn't sterile. He didn't wash his hands or something.
He was drunk too, right?
They think so.
He gave an infection and he died.
Gave him an infection. What did Bubby call it? Some kind of blood infection from the circumcision, erysipelas. And he died. She said he was a beautiful boy. She said he was gorgeous. So she called the VON, Victoria Order of Nurses, to come in and take care of him every day, Bobby. And this was January, mind you. He was born December 31st. He was New Year's baby. His picture was in the paper for years afterwards.
He's January 1st or December 31st?
He's born, first baby born New Year's Eve. New Year's. First baby born on New Year's Day. First in Windsor. So I came in one day, must have been after school, and she's bathing Bobby in January with the windows wide open. And this is an infant. And how old must I have been? I think I'm 17 years older than Bobby. 16 or 17. Can't remember. So I came in and I said, "You're fired. Get out of here and don't come back." I said, "I'll take care of my brother." So I closed the windows and I bathed him and I took care of him. I didn't want to see her again. What kind of nurse was she? So, and then I would have to heat up his bottles. And you know, babies get up at night. They don't sleep through the night. He'd get up at night. And although he didn't cry during the night, it was like midnight or something, for his bottle. And I would have to go and get his bottle very quietly and try and keep him so he wouldn't cry. Because if he woke up my father, he'd come yelling in the bedroom, you know, "Can't you keep him quiet? What's he crying for? He woke me up." So I'd have to try and keep Bobby real quiet. I'd give him his bottle and I'd rock him. I was like his mother for a couple of weeks until my mom came home from the hospital.
Did Zadie ever abuse you?
Yeah.
In what way?
He hit me.
He hit you?
Yeah. Kept smacking me and chasing me around the house. I'd run away from him. He keeps slapping me.
Did he make you bleed? Did he bruise you? Did you have to go to the hospital?
I don't know. I was crying, so, you know. It's the only thing he knew. That's all they know in Russia. Russian people, they're like that. European people, I think we discussed it before. They only know to hit with their hands. They don't understand thinking. Can't remember the name of the town he came from. Minsk? Maybe it was Minsk. He came through Russia, Poland. Came through China and Japan, and they finally landed in Toronto.
How long did he keep this up until you were how old?
I don't remember. I guess I wanted to forget it. I don't remember. That's why my mother sent me to Florida for my last year in high school, because he was beating me then too, at the cottage. I forget what it was about. He hit me because I wanted to keep a dog or something. I don't know what it was, why he did that. I can't remember now.
So the reason you went to Florida was to avoid being abused by your father?
More or less, and my mother thought I deserved it because I took care of Bobby and, you know, I took over the mother role for a while and I helped her a lot. And she thought I deserved to. Also, I think I flunked. I flunked arithmetic, I think. And they wanted me to take it over for a year. So she thought, everything considered, it'd be better if I graduated in Florida. And my Aunt Shirley wanted me to come, because my aunt, I was her favorite. And she always loved me. I brought a letter, too, that she sent me about you. She said, "You're a wonderful boy. You sent her all those things."
Auntie Shirley?
You send her big pencils and stuff. And she said, you have a wonderful boy there. He's very thoughtful. I brought the letter.
I typed out her letters to her on the computer, and I made the font very large.
Yeah, she liked that.
I have some dishes. My china over there is hers.
What?
My china, my dishes?
Yeah.
Our Aunt Shirley, she sent them to me.
She sent them to you?
Yeah.
No kidding. Toby, these are bone china. So treat them very well, like you do. Another fine mess you got me into.
Do you believe in God?
I did believe in God, but if there was a God, how did the Holocaust happen? I saw something on Angel the other night. What's her name that plays the angel? God loves you. I was sent by God because God loves you. That's all she says on the program. God loves you.
What do you think about religion?
I think it's here to stay, don't you?
I don't know.
It's here to stay. Here's the thing. I don't understand how they go with long black coats, big beards, and big hats when it's 99 degrees outside. I can't understand that as long as I live. And also, how did the Holocaust happen if there's a God? How could he have let such horrible things happen? So, do you hear this little towel? And I loved it. Daryl showed it to me when he was in college. It says, I love them little mousies. Mousies,
what I love to eat.
Bite they teeny heads off. Nibble eat they tiny feet.
Yeah. Say again now.
What?
What were you saying?
I said, you know, it's wonderful. All my children are very good about watching what they eat. And staying fit and slim. Wayne just cut out all sweets.
Wayne J. Miller, first child, first son.
Salty. The only one that doesn't watch his diet is Daryl. And I think mostly that has to do because he has so much stress.
Daryl Richard Miller, second child, second son.
Children, by and large, are pretty good. They're awfully smart. Thank God for that. I thank God every day.
Do you remember, I don't know about Wayne, do you remember breaking a hockey stick on Daryl's head and giving him stitches?
Yeah.
Good job.
And I went and got a plastic surgeon, and he says, no, you did not. You're lying. I says, your father told me which plastic surgeon to get, and I got him. He said I was lying. For years, he didn't believe that I got him a plastic surgeon. He says, well, if you did it, he did a lousy job. Do you see a scar on him?
Do you remember being in Hawaii with me and Marissa?
Marissa Lee Miller Mark, third child, only daughter.
I was annoying you. And it looked like you were going to strike me, and I tripped. I, you know, backed away quickly. I recoiled and tripped over the bed on my own, and then like fell over and smacked my head into the. They had a. It's the dog.
Dave T. Brown, dog with human name.
It smacked my head into the base of a lamp and cut it open, and they.
Oh Jesus. I don't remember that. What happened? Did you go to the hospital?
Yeah, I remember you telling tell the doctors it was an accident. It was an accident, which it was. But, you know, but not that,
I don't remember that.
And we got, I don't know if I got stitches. I think they put on liquid skin or something. They shaved a little part of my head and then.
I don't even remember that.
What was the first time you saw Dad or he saw you? How did he pick you
up?
Mary? Dad.
Oh, that was funny. I worked in admitting. before I became a medical secretary. And I used to admit Connie Agra, remember her name. She was about my age, and she used to come to Harper Hospital every year to get a face sanding. She had smallpox, and she used to have those marks on her face. She'd come to the plastic surgeon, and he'd sand her face every year. And then I didn't have a car at that time. And she would always go for a week or two to McGregor Center on Jefferson to recuperate. It was like a rehab. And I would go after work on the bus to see her because she didn't know anybody in the city except me. You know, I got to know her by admitting her. So I'd go and see her every time. And this one time she said, you know, Ruth, there's a nice young doctor here. I think, how did she say? You'd like to meet him or he'd like to meet you, something like that. I says, oh, that's all right, Connie. Don't bother. Anyways, the next time I came to visit her, he came into the room. I guess she asked him to come in or something. And he was just going off duty. So he asked if he could drive me home. I says, well, I'm going to Windsor. You know, I was commuting back and forth. He said, I'll take you to Windsor. So that was how we met.
Do you remember one of your first conversations?
No. You know, I married your father. I knew he was a doctor. I don't think I knew he was a psychiatrist. After we married, I think it was even, might have been on our wedding night, he says, you know, I'm in psychiatry. And he says, didn't even wait till we were married a few weeks or a few. He says, I'm in analysis. That's after we were married, he told me this. I'm in analysis. I says, why are you in analysis? He says, I'm going to be a psychoanalyst. In order to be that, I have to be in analysis myself.
It's part of his training.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I didn't know that. I says, well, if that's what you have to do, you have to do it. He says, but the thing is, he may tell me I should get divorced. Excuse me. And I figured, we just got married. And he's telling me this. You know, I couldn't understand him. Didn't understand him. Your father hit me once when I was pregnant with Wayne. So I left the house. I was going to leave him and walk away. I did walk away. He followed me.
Why did he hit you?
I don't remember, but he said he promised me he'd never do it again. And he never did. We lived at Bubby's till we got our own place, till we got our own apartment.
Your first sex happened under your mom's roof?
Yeah, his mother.
Oh, you mean Bubby Miller?
Huh?
Bubby Miller?
Yeah. His mom used to do the laundry, and she says she found the sheet the day after, the next morning. She was sure to tell us. I didn't particularly enjoy it, no.
I don't have to.
I didn't enjoy it with your father, but I don't think I loved him at the beginning, but I learned to love him because I had four children with him. And I guess I kind of grew an affection for him.
You want some coffee?
I had my tea and toast and my vitamins, so I'm all set for a while. Hello? Marissa? How would I know? I don't speak to you that often. Why? You want to speak to Toby? You want to speak to Toby? Okay, just a minute. She wants to speak to you quickly.
Marissa was calling to get the story of our mother's mother, our grandmother, Dorothy, and her sister, Shirley, our so-called Auntie Shirley. Both women were orphaned early in life. Their father, our great-grandfather, Abraham, died first of an unknown cause. The mother, our great-grandmother, Rachel, was next, and Marissa also wanted to know what happened to her.
Both girls had a very sad childhood. My Aunt Shirley was more like Cinderella, and my mother, like I say, was shifted from house to house, and she never really had a home. So both girls had pretty sad childhoods.
Ruth's nephew, Aaron, also phoned with questions remarkably similar to Marissa's. Answers to both follow.
Aaron? Hi, how are you? There were three sisters. My mother's mother was Rachel, and her sister was Heike, and I think that's Helen in English. And Heike and Celia, two of the women were twins, and I'm not sure which two. I think it was Heike and Celia. So there were three sisters, and one of the sisters was Bubby Dorothy's mother. See, what happened after the husband died, the two sisters didn't want to leave her alone in England by herself. So they matched her up with an older man. Bubby's mother. Their father passed away. And the two sisters, Heike and Celia. Celia brought up Bubby. Heike brought up Auntie Shirley. She was like Cinderella, because Auntie Heike had five kids. And Auntie Shirley was the sixth in the family, so she got all the dirty work. So they split them up. They brought them back to Toronto after the first husband died, their father, they matched her up with an older man because they said it wasn't good for a single woman to be alone in the city with two children. So they matched her up with the older man, and she became pregnant. And when she went into the hospital to have the baby, it was late at night. Her doctor wasn't available. She had an intern. An intern took her, and he killed her and the baby. And Auntie Heike, yeah, she died in delivery. And Auntie Heike and Auntie Celia, my mother says all she remembers is that they were falling all over the floor in grief, screaming and falling all over the floor in the hospital. They were fainting because they couldn't believe it happened, because Bubby's mother was so young, just a young woman. I think she was in her late 20s, early 30s, something like that. So I don't know why they split the girls up, but they did. My mother only went to, I think, grade 5 or 6, but she was self-taught. She was very clever, innately clever. And my aunt became a buyer for two top stores in Miami. And she did a lot of volunteer work, as did my mother and father. A lot of volunteer work in Windsor, and my aunt, wherever, whatever city she landed in, she did volunteer work. Waikiki, Hawaii. I've only been on the line 2 hours. I don't care as long as it's on Waikiki Beach. And what is your name? How do you spell the name? Which is cheaper? That has a view of the ocean? What happened to the 139? We want to be able to see some of the ocean, which we were told was 119. Oh, well then Two King. She had a 139 at the Moana Surf Rider. Kailani, Kuani or whatever. Is there a patio? Is that how you see the ocean? There's no shuttle from the airport to the hotel. I was told there's a shuttle, so we'll see them there, God willing, on the 4th. Bye-bye. Whew, what a day's work.
Well, it's time for the Hawaii trip. It's Friday morning, about 7:30 a.m., September 4th, and we're on our way to Hawaii. So cool. We get to bypass that whole line because of her.
I asked for a bulkhead seat.
Yeah.
And I needed a wheelchair, and they put me in the back of the plane. I asked for a bulkhead aisle.
We've been heading to that volcano, which is there. That volcano is known as Diamond Head.
Diamond Head.
There ain't no diamonds over there, because the jewelry shop got them all. Sir, put down that video.
We're here at Waikiki Beach.
Here, where's that?
No, no. I'm scared. I don't think I did. Where is that? There's the sheriff of Waikiki. Where we stayed in 1974. Plenty of keys. She's officially in the water. Alright, okay. Retreat.
Okay.
And what is it?
To Hawaii to get fish and chips.
We're on our way to see Auntie Shirley and Uncle Max's graves at Kalamanamiyami Memorial Park Cemetery. How are you liking things?
Mililani Cemetery.
Now we gotta find where she's Uncle Max and Aunt Shirley are located.
He said a green light. Oh,
it's
green.
Way up there.
I see it. It's section NN.
NN.
Block 89. How do you find block 89?
We got numbers here. 111, I think, or it's 114. We're looking for 89. I thought it was close on this one. Jesus, it's tough finding them. I found them.
Oh, my God, you're wonderful.
This is what screwed us over. It was mislabeled. Here's where they are.
Went through there 20 times. Toby wouldn't give up. She was born in 1911. She died a year after my mom.
I'm putting some of these stones
ready
on there.
Give up.
Oh. Yeah, look at the one I brought. Nice big boy. This is coral from just diving. There you go, Andy.
We love you both.
All right.
God bless who?
God bless you, Toby.
All right, then.
You never give up. That's the way to win in this world.
That's why I'm so successful.
You'll be successful. It'll take you a little bit longer, Toby, but you'll be okay.
That was written was a song that simply said,
I was giving you five more minutes and then I was going.
The man of my word.
You just missed the hula dance.
This is what I'm doing.
They were all taking pictures of her.
And I want the world to know this.
They were all taking pictures of the hula dancer.
Name again? You asked what our name is?
Yeah.
Is it for you?
Yeah.
Is it your birthday?
Yeah.
Yes. That's good enough.
January 24th.
That's good enough.
It's Ruth and my son Toby.
You can just do her.
For Ruth and Toby.
Happy birthday and also out to your son. We'd like to show you some tiny bubbles as you ask. This one is for you.
Thank you.
Tiny bubble in the wine makes me happy, makes me feel fine.
Look, that guy looks like Bobby. Look, Mom. No, seriously. It's Daryl.
Looks more like Daryl, right?
That's some fur.
Huh? You're right. Put your arm around me.
Okay. Woman, right? Own woman.
Yeah.
Whatever you talk, you need to carefully. Because whatever you talk to, you're talking, but she will hurt. She cry. So, you be careful what you talk to her. Need to choose the word to talk to her.
Choose the words carefully.
Yes. Because she will stop in her mind. I just want to tell you that.
Look at that ball is standing in the air by itself. I'm supposed to give a donation to him. Where's the hotel? I gotta sit down.
And then she takes off the glasses and he's that old man. I like a pair of glasses like that. Here we go.
Mom locked herself out.
First time I've done that.
Did my mom stop by?
Yeah, she did. She was doing her own thing. She was talking about the river area of the South, I guess where she lives, somewhere in Miami and stuff.
I wouldn't mind getting for two people, but I cannot eat that much. I can only eat little dribbles. Okay?
She wanted me to steal an omelet from the omelet bar. Which said the truth I don't really care about, but I thought we were going to get caught or they were going to say something, which I wanted to get on video. But now I should do it.
Stop.
I think we should just pay him.
What?
I think we should just pay him.
Just forget. I just want to try what it is. I just want pepper on my part.
It's all yours.
Huh?
It's all yours.
Oh, boy.
And then mommy the truth.
Delicious, isn't it?
I brought you a present too.
Thank you.
Hey, and another present.
Thank you, Toby. I was next door in Caddyshack.
The original?
Huh? Huh?
The original?
No, Caddyshack 2. I think it was with Mason, Jackie Mason. But I think it was in one, Don Murray. You know, he was cleaning the pools and everything. Somebody pooped in the pool. Also, they were eating these Baby Ruth chocolate bars, and it fell in the pool. He's cleaning up, and he finds the chocolate bars, and the women are watching on the side, and he picks one up and eats it. Good. And she faints dead away.
Where are we going now?
Going to the airport to go back to California. Wonderful trip. Don't you think?
Yeah, I do. I enjoyed it. That's it.
That was very, very easy. You can't hear people using that lavatory because of security reasons. The cockpit. Well, where do these people go to the lavatory?
First class goes there. We're going to see Elaine Soleimani, and Mom's already in there. That's the place, the rest home or assisted living facility she lives in. It smells like pee-pee in here.
Oh, God. Not me, please.
So, can I give you a hug?
Yes.
Do you want me to get something to drink?
Yes, how about you?
How's so nice to see you.
Oh, good to see you too. Honest to goodness.
We wanted to bring you something. We didn't know what to bring. I was going to bring flowers. Toby said, what if she's allergic to flowers?
Nothing. Nothing is fine. Just you're here. It's fine. Maria,
you know, I called you a lot, and nobody ever answers. I don't know why.
When?
From home, from Florida.
May I
called
water?
You quite a
what?
Bit.
Yeah.
Nobody ever
water.
Answered the phone. And then a couple of times she said that you couldn't come to the phone when I called. I said, forget it, I'm not going to call anymore.
I don't know. I just, the phone is right by my bedside. I don't know.
When Jala called you the other day, I said, don't bother Jala, she won't answer. And she said, yes, she answered right away.
Of course I do. I'm in bed there. Sometimes I'm in the bathroom.
It's enough already. They've seen me.
I told you, you don't got a choice here.
The family's been bugging me to have one of the kids
loves it.
Tape me or something. So Toby's doing is making, since I came here, is making up for last time.
Okay, yes.
We're going to the dentist. The first time I've been to the dentist in I think about maybe 10 years, maybe longer. Mom had to take a break and sit down.
What's that?
You want me to do that?
No. Yeah, go ahead.
You want to take
it?
You want to video?
I can't do
this?
It as well as you.
You want to video?
I don't think I can
I'm
do it.
Video first.
Is it on?
Posterity.
Oh.
Is it on?
Yeah.
Well, just look in the viewfinder, there, honey.
I'm looking.
All right, so you can see what I'm doing. Sugar is more addicting than cocaine.
It's acid. It wears away. It eats
sugar
away.
Sugar will wear away everything. Do you see all the blood here? Good. All right.
Is it safe?
Is it safe? It's safe. It is definitely safe. Yeah. It's safe. There you go.
What?
How did Mike Bass woo you?
Oh, you remember we went to Disneyland?
I remember going to the Orange Bowl parade.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And I had really bad gas.
Really?
Yeah. And I didn't think anyone was noticing, and I just kept letting it go. It was all silent. And then afterwards, you gave me hell. You knew it was me, and you were just thought it was disgusting, and I, you know, just what I did. And but it didn't scare him off.
Do you know what Darrow did to me, speaking of gas? But he figured the only way to get me to marry him was through the children, because he knew that I was for the children. So he started getting me nearly new cars, and he would give it to me at a very cheap price. See, I was always attracted to men that wore glasses, because to me that meant they were very intelligent. Like your father wore glasses, that was a finishing touch for me to marry him. He had glasses. And Mike had glasses, horn-rimmed glasses. I love men with horn-rimmed glasses. I cried when I finally made love with him. I was crying, and he didn't know why I was crying. I was crying because if I hadn't gotten divorced from my first husband, this would never have happened. I would never be with you. I don't know if I told him that. I would never have been with him, because I never thought I'd be divorced. And it was like, I didn't feel right about it. I just didn't feel right about it.
Well, you said when you got divorced, who got divorced in the first marriage? Who asked for the divorce in the first marriage?
I remember Marissa was playing in the bedroom with Cheryl.
Soller.
And I see somebody coming up to the front door, and he looked very official, and it scared me. He looked scary. I went to the door, and he gives me the papers, and he walked away. They were divorce papers from your father. Well, I traveled a lot. We traveled a lot.
You and Mike?
That was about it. But he didn't like it when I went to visit my children, you know, spent so much time away from them.
He didn't like us, or most of us, or and I, probably
really?
With good reason.
You know that for a fact.
You know it as a fact, too. Why didn't he give you the condo?
Oh, yeah, right. I think he had something with Daryl, and he didn't want Daryl to get the condo or anything.
Divorce number two with Mike, there were fireworks in the court, like, you know, you hitting him and him insulting you.
No, I just didn't talk to him. I got mad at him.
You smacked him. You told me. You smacked him.
I smashed him.
Smacked him.
Oh, yeah, at the divorce hearing.
Didn't he insult you and you smacked him?
He insulted me, and I slapped him, and the lawyers weren't looking, and all they heard was this crack. And he had a red face with my finger marks on it. And because he said something he should have said if he was a gentleman. And the lawyer turned around. He says, "What happened?" And we said, "Nothing."
He said nothing?
Huh?
He said nothing?
We both did. He would have been embarrassed to say something happened.
What did he say? What did he say that insulted you?
Nothing. He was afraid to say anything more for fear I'd give him another crack across the face.
What was the original insult?
I didn't want to say, but it was not something you say if you're a gentleman.
Can you tippy toe around it?
Huh?
Can you tippy toe around it?
Oh, he came out with it. And then Bobby was upset that I hit him. And I was proud of it, that I had the nerve to do it. I never hit anybody before that.
Never hit anyone?
Once, I think. So, I never hit any man. I never struck anybody like that. But it had to be done.
What? Talk more about my life and mystery to you.
I don't know. I can't figure it out, dear. And I've given up trying to with any of you. Believe me.
No, you had something personal to say. Go ahead and say it.
What?
You had something personal to say about me. Go ahead and say it.
About you?
Yeah.
I can't figure out what you do and why you do it and when you do it.
What's there to figure out? I'm not doing anything. I've been a disappointment. My career, I haven't had a career.
You're not a disappointment. Your life isn't over.
I didn't say that. I'm just saying I'm trying to relate what you just said. You can't figure out what I do. That's because I don't do anything.
Oh, okay.
You know,
thanks for explaining.
It's not like I'm hiding something from you. Do you
No,
think?
I know you're not, dear. It's just I can't.
What don't you understand? I think I've been pretty open about that throughout the years, what I've been doing and what I've been trying to do. What don't you understand?
I don't understand you.
What do you mean?
I don't mean it negatively.
No, it sounds very positive. What did you? What do you mean particularly? Because I've tried never to hide or lie to you about anything.
No, you haven't. You haven't, dear. You've been very straightforward to me, and I love you very much. And I know you're going to be successful. And I'm proud of you, just like I'm proud of my kids, sort of, with one or two exceptions. But I love you all very much. You're all I ever wanted. Do you understand?
I understand you wanted kids and you got kids, but not all of them have lived up to your expectations.
Well, you were my dream. Just turned out to be a nightmare sometime. But, you know, I have to tell you, I believe what George Burns said on his 100th birthday. They asked him what his secret to long life was and happiness. He says, happiness is having a large family. Oh, wait, how did he put it? Happiness is living in a big city and having a large family far away from you in another city. That's the secret to happiness. Because if I lived in Michigan, I would have been dead many years ago. Okay? But I love you all. I've tried to keep away from you and not interfere in your lives too much, except to help you, which I hope I have succeeded in doing. So that's what I've tried to do. I've tried to kind of guide you and help all of you. I haven't always succeeded. I don't think I've halfway succeeded, but I've tried. I've done the best I could. That's all I can say. And I know you'll work out for the best. I know you will, Toby, too, because you don't give up. That's the secret. And you've all been very good to me. Wayne's been wonderful to me. And Daryl and you are marvelous to me. And Marissa, when she had the means, was wonderful to me. I just wished I could help her more. Okay. You know, I said that you've all been very good to me, and I appreciate your coming when I was in the hospital. But when I was recuperating and while I was in the hospital, I would have appreciated it a lot more if some of my children didn't keep telling me how messy my home was.
But it was.
And how they had to clean it. You know, I was recuperating, coming back from the dead. I didn't have to hear this. I wouldn't do it to you. And if you had come a few weeks later, my home would have been transformed the way it always is, nice and clean and beautiful.
What
mean? I don't want to hear this from you. I don't tell you how to live.
Okay.
I don't criticize you. Stop criticizing me.
Okay, I'm
I can't take it.
Okay.
Stop criticizing. Hey. You want me to criticize you all the time?
No.
I'll do it.
Well, I mean, some of the stuff I agree with.
I live and let live. Thank God I don't depend on you for a living.
You brought this up.
Thank God I don't depend on you for a living. I support myself. Thank goodness. I've only once in my life had to ask you for money. That was when I was in the hospital and couldn't help myself.
You know.
Don't tell me I was living in filth. You're lying. You've been trying to pick a fight with me since I got here, and it won't happen. I won't fight with you. But don't tell me I was living in filth like you're living in a castle.
I didn't mean
and my son, after all I've done for him, calls his mother, as he calls her names. I hope your head is chopped off. Calls me names, my son. I never heard of this in my life. They're streetwalkers and the father's in jail. They wouldn't think of calling their mother a name. Wouldn't think of it. He calls me names. I never dreamed of when I wanted children. It's all I ever wanted. I never dreamed of this. You remember that when I'm dead, what you called me. Put it on my gravestone. Here lies Essie. How many mothers help their children and don't expect to be reimbursed? I read
Dear. Hey, I've never said, I keep saying you shouldn't do that. You should keep the money yourself.
Yes,
you should buy yourself. You should go traveling, buy yourself whatever you want. What have I said? I keep saying that.
Yes, you have. Yes, you did.
And I'm not saying, you know, you keep complaining about what I think of your apartment. I want you to live like, you know, by yourself, you know, if you want a nice new chair or whatever the hell you want. You know, I think you should do it. You make it seem like a bad thing.
I don't want
all
anything.
Right. Well,
I'm
okay.
happy
well,
with
that's
what
fine.
I
that's fine. But that's what I was saying. And if you want to go traveling, you should travel. You should do whatever. You know,
Use your money.
I just did it. Didn't I?
Yeah.
I just did it.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, it was like squeezing water from a rock. You know, you should just enjoy it. Do it. Spend it. Splurge. Go. Do your thing. You hope my head was chopped off, did you say?
I'll take it back.
I don't think I don't think I said anything like that to you since I was a little kid.
Hello, puppies! How are you? It's Elise! How are you?
I love you too, Elise. Very much.
I have to pull down my dress. I love you, puppies. This is why I've been coming to visit you. I take time out of my busy, busy schedule.
Oh, yeah.
So I may call you or visit with you in person today. You oh. See? I love you, puppies.
What a surprise.
Yes. Well, that is why I come and visit you so often when I go to the school and live almost next door to you. I invite you to all my special events because why? I love you, puppies.
Of course you do. I love you too.
But I love you more. I love you the most. That is why you hold such a special place in my heart.
You want to turn off the fan?
Yenta.
You calling me Yenta?
That was what I was trying to think of when I said you have a loose tongue. You know what a Yenta is?
Maybe. Thanks.
What is this all about? What is this?
They're just, I wonder if I got them on tape. It's just a checkpoint. Oh, because there's it went up. It's orange alert now. Somebody.
You do this all the time?
Sometimes when it went up, the flight risk, the terrorist alert thing.
You're kidding.
It went up when we were coming back from Hawaii. It was that orange. Somebody threatened to do something, or somebody did something, or they caught somebody, or I don't know.
Jesus, I hope my luck hasn't run out.
I think you're going to be around longer than anybody else. I tell you, I think you're going to outlive all the kids. Well, at least
what?
Me. You're going to outlive all the kids, I think.
Don't talk like that. No mother wants to do that.
I think you're going to be dancing on my grave for sure.
You're going to be buried at sea? No, I don't. No mother wants to outlive
you're
gonna
her
do, children.
You'll be like taking somebody, pushing somebody, and push her wheelchair all over my grave.
Don't talk like that. You're gonna be all right. You take care of yourself and you watch what you eat. That's what's wonderful. You watch everything you eat.
Okay, whatever.
That I like. And I start
now
watching.
I watch everything I eat.
Mm-hmm. You watch yourself eating it, right? No, but you don't eat too much salt. And I always read the packages and I found out everything has sugar. Even milk has sugar in it. Don't forget to wash with warm salt water.
Stay, boy. You stay. Good boy.
Okay. Please take care of your teeth, okay? Please. All right?
Okay.
Thank you. Good luck. Good luck. Don't worry.
Okay.
Son, Ruth Rochelle Bornstein Miller, was born January 24th, 1928 in Toronto. The middle name, Rochelle, was from Rachel, which is the grandmother that she never met. Rachel died in London in childbirth in 1920, leaving her two daughters, Shirley and Dorothy, orphans.
Auntie Ruthie, I can't believe you are gone. When I was younger, I didn't get to know you like I should have, and I regret it now. Over the last 20 years, I came to know you and appreciate you more. I will always remember the first time you saw my infant daughter and the way you held her, and I saw that great smile of yours. Why do we take some people for granted and realize how special they are only until they're gone?
Hi, I'm Claire, Ruth's younger brother, and Friday she took care of me one last time.
Yeah. Clarence, the angel of death came every day, so I couldn't figure out why.
Though much is taken, much abides. And though we are not now that strength, that which in old days moved earth and heaven, that which we are one equal temper of one equal temper of heroic hearts made weak by time and fate, but strong in will. And this is what she wants you to do, to strive, to seek, to find, and not to yield. That's her message.
I'm Daryl, my mother's second eldest son, and I had tossed together a few things that I wanted to mention as well. I just want to say, poor mom, she was just absolutely vibrant to the end, and she literally had a full schedule right to the last day. I had to call several people in recent days and explain to them why she wasn't there, and just very, very active, busy, right to the end.
My mom was committed to being Jewish, not in a theologic sense, but in a profound family or tribal sense.
I, too, received some wonderful Pepsi coupons.
I'd like a show of hands now. How many of you here have ever had milk that was frozen and then defrosted? I have. There should be three other hands going. She was the most influential person in my life. I will miss her more than I know. I love you, Mom. Rest in peace. And I will promise to look after my teeth. She would urge us to eat her cooking with the argument that people in Europe are starving. I urged her to export her cooking to those less fortunate than us. Tikkun olam.
Ruthie, you were famous for taking supplies and leftovers home from restaurants. You? You had a great sense of humor, and even had me pishing in my Pampers as a youngster with your jokes.
And the car stopped just before it went over the cliff. And they both heaved a sigh in relief. And they said, oh, thank God.
about Winchester Cathedral.